Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me. So, sorry. At least I can see you, too. All right, so the next 30 minutes, we're going to talk about KEDA. And KEDA stands for Kubernetes-based event-driven autoscaling. So what KEDA allows you to do is autoscale your workloads on Kubernetes based on events. So, for example, the number of messages in a queue that could be a trigger to scale your workloads. And as we will see later on, that is something that isn't as easy to do by default in Kubernetes. So there's really a gap that KEDA can fill in for you. It runs on any Kubernetes cluster out there, so it doesn't matter where you run it. Today in the demo, I'm going to run it on Azure. But you can do it on any cloud provider or your local laptop, doesn't matter. And it can also scale any container. So you're not tied to a particular technology, program language, SDK, doesn't matter. It can scale any container no matter what you put in it. So it really tries to live up to the promise to make auto-scaling on Kubernetes a simple thing. All right, before we dive in, a little bit about me. My name is Erwin Staal, but you already knew that. I'm an Azure architect working for a consultancy company called Expert in Hilversum, but I actually live in Assen, as you can see on the map here. Used to study in Groningen, so I'm quite familiar here. Actually, one of my teachers from back in the days is in the audience, so I hope that I, after 4 years, him teaching me stuff, I can actually give something back. But let's see. All right, so if we talk about scaling in general, you could say there's two ways in which you can do scaling. First is the horizontal scaling, and there's also vertical scaling. By horizontal, we mean that you could add machines, nodes to your compute power. So you can just add virtual machines or add nodes, workers to a Kubernetes cluster to get more compute resources. That could be a way of scaling your compute. You could also do that vertically by adding more CPU power, memory, etc. to your already existing virtual machines or machines in general. If we then look at what that means for Kubernetes and how you can do scaling in there by default, then this is kind of what we see. You can, again, both do horizontal and vertical scaling. It depends a bit on where you run your cluster and what version, what types you get out of the box, and what work you need to do to actually get the scaling done. But you can do horizontal scaling, but that would mean you could change the number of nodes in your pool to get more compute power. You could also change the number of pods to get a bit more compute power to a particular application. And you can scale vertically, and by that I mean that you can, again, change the size of your node. So you could add more CPUs, more RAM to the nodes in your pool that you already have. Or, since you can also limit the amount of resources that a particular pod can use, you can also play around with that, and in that way give less or more resources to a particular pod. But as I mentioned, it depends a bit on where you run your cluster, which of the options you have, and if they're actually general available or still in a beta phase, for example. If you look at Azure, which is where I do most of my work, then you can do vertical scaling, for example, change the size of nodes, but it's not really there built in. You need to tweak, hack a little bit. So it's easier to just add a new pool and remove the old one than to start changing the size of the nodes of an existing pool. So it depends a bit on where you run the thing. But what is always the case here with the default scaling in Kubernetes is that it can only react to the symptom of the scaling and not the actual cause. It will always react by default to to memory pressure or to CPU pressure. You can do bit scaling on other things, but it's quite hard to do. So what's easy out of the box is CPU and memory. But that's kind of always, that's not why you want to scale. Especially in an event-driven architecture, you want to scale based on events in a queue. Not because of the fact that there are a lot of events in the queue, and you start running that on your cluster, and you then suddenly notice that you need that you ran out of CPU power. So that is where KEDA comes in. Because KEDA can actually scale workloads on Kubernetes based on events. So let's have a bit of a look at what KEDA actually consists of and how it interacts with the rest of your cluster. Like already mentioned, you can install it on any Kubernetes cluster you like, because what they really try to do is use in Kubernetes what is already there and only build what it really what they really needed to build, but leverage what's already there if they can. So what you see is that Kubernetes actually of KEDA exists with three components: the metrics adapter, the controller, and the scalers. Let's start with the scalers over here. A scaler is a thing, a piece of code, that knows how to read the number of metrics from a particular event source. So there's actually a quite a big list available today, and these aren't even all the scalers that are available. But there's scalers for things on Azure, for the queues on Azure, but also scalers that can read particular event sources on AWS, Google, the Google Cloud, and even the IBM Cloud, if anyone might be using that. But also stuff that is cloud agnostic. So also you can also trigger or scale your workloads based on a trigger in MySQL or MSSQL or Postgres. So there's a lot of scalers out there which you can use to scale your workloads. And what then happens is that such a scaler goes out to a particular event source, grabs the number of messages, for example, on a queue, and gives that to the metrics adapter, and the metrics adapter in turn can give that to the already built-in horizontal pod autoscaler. So most of the scaling in your cluster is actually still be done with the default horizontal pod autoscaler that's there anyway. It's just feeding the metrics in a format language, you could say, that the horizontal pod autoscaler actually understands. But what you see here with the orange line is that the horizontal pod autoscaler will scale your workloads from 1 to whatever and back to 1. But you also see the blue line here that says that we can also scale from 1 to 0 and from 0 to 1. That is something, scaling to 0, is something that you cannot do by default in Kubernetes. But KEDA allows you to do that, and that's mainly the job of the controller in the middle. That will scale your workloads to 0 or from 0 up to 1, and then it's up to the horizontal pod autoscaler to do the rest. And that is, especially in event-driven architectures, pretty cool, because it doesn't make sense to run any workloads if there isn't anything to be done anyway. When there aren't any messages on a queue, it doesn't make sense to still keep memory in use because you run a pod. So being able to scale that down to 0 is quite useful in those architectures. All right, so last but not least, what you see in the right corner is that the scalers actually go out to the external event source, the trigger source, and then the pods also still go out to that external event source. So let's have a bit of a closer look at how that actually works, because that is an important distinction to how KEDA does things and how alternatives to KEDA do their thing. So what you see in KEDA is that KEDA goes out to a queue, for example, line 1 here, using the scaler, and then try to see how many messages are on the queue, and based on those amount of messages, KEDA will scale your application. But it is still your application that needs to go out to that queue and actually grab the data, the message from that queue. It's not KEDA that's gonna give you the data, you still need to go out there yourself. Whereas in alternative products, that's been done for you. So the alternative products go out to a queue, for example, and actually grab the data and then give that to your application, mostly over HTTP. And the benefit of that is that your application only needs to be able to talk HTTP, and that's quite easy. We can do that in any language. Anyone can almost do that. But the downside of that is that you also cannot work with the benefits that you get when you directly work with your event source. If you, for example, work with a queue, then it comes in handy to be able to do dead lettering. If something goes wrong in your application, you want that message to be back on the queue, or even go to an error queue so you can handle that later. That is something that you need to do yourself in the alternative scenario, But if you work with the KEDA one, then you still need to use the SDKs of the particular event source and do that yourself. So there's pros and cons to both of them. But I am, I must admit, a lazy developer. So I'm gonna show you later on that there is an alternative way to do that. Still use KEDA, but don't have to write all the plumbing to connect to the queue yourself. So that's what I'm gonna try to show you in the demo that I have prepared. So imagine that you have a system, and that system that it's an event-driven system, obviously. And what it does, it reads messages from a queue and it starts processing those messages. And what you can imagine is that, especially in those event-driven situations, you see that that the number of work to be done is never the same. So there might be 1,000 messages on that queue right now to be processed, and then there's hours of nothing, and then suddenly there's 10,000 of messages on that queue that you need to process. If you would do that on your Kubernetes cluster, on which you also run other workloads like APIs and websites, for example, you might get into trouble because you might easily overload that cluster by handling all those events on that cluster. You need to, that cluster would have to start scaling. That takes a bit of time. If you look at Azure, for example, the Azure Kubernetes service, it takes around 2-3 minutes to add an additional node. So by doing the scaling on the Kubernetes cluster, you might actually impact other workload as well, or process the messages more slowly than you would actually like to do. So what we can do, both on Azure, but also on Azure Cloud, or other clouds, is use something that is called virtual nodes. And virtual nodes allow you to run that particular workload also somewhere else. And in Azure, that would be Azure Container Instances. So what you can do, you can create a cluster, a Kubernetes cluster, that also has a connection, so to say, with the virtual nodes. And based on how busy your cluster already is, it might decide to run the workload on the cluster itself, or give that to the virtual nodes to run it somewhere else. That can be a very cost-effective and performance optimization. And the nice thing is that you as a developer only get to talk to just one Kubernetes environment, and the system itself will figure out where to actually run your workload and to see if it can actually do that on the AKS, your default cluster, or if that's already quite busy and it needs to scale out to the Azure Container Instances. So today I'm gonna try to show you an example of how to do that. How am I doing? All right, halfway. All right, so that's actually the wrong one. All right, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna write a little piece of code in Python, obviously, which I've never done before. I'm a .NET guy, Microsoft, etc. But here I am, yeah, so I'm gonna do my best. So, but as I said, I'm quite a lazy developer, so I'm not gonna write that code to connect to my queue myself. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna use Azure Functions. And Azure Functions are the serverless offering by Microsoft in the Azure Cloud, but you can actually also run that in a Docker container and therefore put it on a Kubernetes cluster wherever you want to. And what Azure Functions do is that they have something which is called a trigger, and a trigger can cause an Azure function to run. And with those triggers, you can actually bind to, for example, a queue, have it connect to that queue and trigger whenever there's a message on that queue. And all the plumbing around connecting with that queue has been done for you by the Azure Function SDK and runtime. You don't have to do that yourself. So let's see what that actually looks like. So what you can do is you can use the Azure Function CLI to create yourself a new environment. And that's done using this command. I do specify that I want to run it in a Docker container, hence the dash Docker. And since we're here today, I'm gonna go for option 4. All right, so it will do some initialization, setting up, etc. So then I have to run func new to actually create me a new Azure function. And what you see is that there's quite a few triggers out of the box available that you can use to work with the Azure function and to have it triggered. There's obviously a lot of Azure stuff, but there's also HTTP and Kafka and other things. And today we're gonna work with option 12, which is the Azure queue storage. We can give it a name, but I'm fine today with the queue trigger. So let's see, yeah, it actually did something. Let's spin up an environment to see what we actually get. So this is the actual Azure function that it creates for you when you do this initialization. So what you see is that there isn't that much code, but it actually works. I need to specify a connection string, yeah, but then it actually works. So whenever I put something on the queue, this function will be triggered and I can actually do something with the data on that queue. It uses the Azure function import and then here specifies what kind of message I expect in this particular function. So there's two things that I need to do to get this actually running. First, I need to go in my function.json file and specify the environment variable that holds the connection string to my queue. And if I would run this thing locally, then this is where I will specify that connection string. And that's it. I could run that from my laptop, for example, and get testing. But if I would want to push it out to a Kubernetes cluster and actually run it there, I can use some command line again to do that. Deploy. I need to specify name and also need to specify the registry. So this is it. If I run this, what it will then do, it will build the Docker container. It will push that to my registry and it will then start running that on the Kubernetes cluster that I've currently configured. But what you will quite often do is that you want to be a bit more in control of what actually is going to happen and what is actually going to be deployed on your cluster. So what you can do is to actually do a dry run and push that stuff into a file. So that it actually outputs what it would do for you in a standard Kubernetes YAML file, so you can actually see what's going on under the hood and do some customization. So instead of you seeing me typing, let's quickly switch over to something that should be working. And this is then actually the output of that command that I just showed you. So what you first see is that it creates a secret for you because we need to hold that connection string somewhere. And by default, that's going to be a secret. It then creates a deployment. And this is still all default Kubernetes stuff. If you ever deployed something to Kubernetes, it should be very familiar. It's where we specify the container that we want to run. It specifies the environment variables, readiness probes, health probes, et cetera, et cetera. The only thing that I did add is this particular part over here. And this will make sure that I kind of tell the connection, I don't care where you run the stuff. If you do that on Kubernetes or if you do that on your virtual nodes, I don't care. Decide that for me. And then down here, this is actually a KEDA specific thing on Kubernetes, the scaled object. This defines how you want to scale that workload on the cluster. So again, it references the deployment we just saw. And down here, it specifies and lists how you want that application, that workload to be triggered. And since we use the Azure queue, this obviously says Azure queue, and there's a bit of settings down here to specify how you want to do things now to connect to that thing, etc. What you can also do is give a few additional parameters. So for example, the polling interval, this one says, I want you to go out to my queue every 5 seconds to see if there's any work to be done. 5 seconds might be a bit much in a production system, but for a demo it works well. And you also get to specify the minimum and maximum replica count. So I've set this one to 0. Remember that you normally cannot do that in Kubernetes, but now we can. And I've set the maximum to 20. I think it's always good to actually give a limit to make sure that you don't overload any other systems. I mean, this container might be talking to a database, and we don't want to overload that one. So it's always good to have maximum there as well. And last but not least, there's a cooldown period that's also set to 5 seconds for now. And what that does is when there's no work to be done anymore on that queue, it will wait 5 seconds before it starts terminating containers. Normally, it might make sense to just keep them alive for a while to be able to respond to new work quicker. But this allows you to do the cooldown anywhere where you would like that to be done. All right, now let's see this in action and see if it actually works. Sorry, I thought it would be a wise idea to have a white background. Normally it works better in presentation than black, but sorry. All right. A little less than 10 minutes, that should be fine. All right, so let's first have a quick look at the cluster that we are going to deploy the stuff to. I actually already deployed the things because we don't want to wait for that to be happen. So what we see here, when I do a kubectl get nodes, is that we shoot two nodes. The first one, the AKS pool 2, that is a node that is actually always running, and that's in my Kubernetes pool. The second one, the virtual node, ACI Linux, is obviously the Azure container instance. The one that's not actually running right now, but it's more the connection to it. What you do see here is that I run two different versions on that. You might not want to do that in production. Just so you know. All right, let's see if there's anything running at the moment in my default namespace. No, so there's nothing running here because we've scaled down to zero. But if we look at the horizontal pod autoscaler rule, then we actually do see something being deployed. So it's actually there. This is the autoscaling rule. And what you see here is that the minimum pods over there is actually set to 1. And that is because, again, Kubernetes doesn't understand scaling to 0. This took me quite some time when I first started out with KEDA. I think around 2 hours before I realized, they just show it incorrectly. Don't go there. So this is actually correct. All right, so what we can do is now actually get this thing to work. Let's start doing some scaling. So what I'm gonna do here is first do a watch on the pods and also do a watch on the deployments. So we can see whenever I start putting things in that queue, we should actually see it do some work. So what I did, I hope it was on the same page. It's not. Let's go there. All right. So what I did, I created a small application, sorry, .NET, to put some items in the queue. I think there's around 250 items being put in the queue, and that should get the scaling going. So let's start filling that stuff. There we go. So the program is now going to put things in that queue. And if it all works well, then we should see, that's already happening, that the thing starts scaling. And as you can see, it starts scaling out quite quickly to already 4 pods. And it will continue to scale out to 8 and then 16, kind of every 5 seconds, because that's the interval that I specified. That's going to 8. And what you see over here in the first terminal, this is the node that actually runs this work on. So up until now, it decided that it could perfectly run this workload on the AKS, on the default pool. But now you also see a few of the virtual nodes coming by as well. So it now also decided that it was a good idea to actually start running stuff somewhere else. What you do see is that the pods on your Kubernetes cluster, they kind of start in seconds. They get an IP address quite quickly and actually do some work quite quickly. The ones on the virtual node take around 40, 50 seconds to actually spin up and get some work done. So there's a bit of a delay there. But it does allow you to scale kind of indefinitely quite quickly. All right, so what we also see now is that all the messages on my queue have been processed. So down here, you see that it quite quickly also went down to scaling to 0 again. And as you see in the upper one, all the pods have been terminated. So the cluster is free again to do other things. All right, that was one of what I wanted to get across today. So I wonder if there's any questions. Anything else you want to know? Yeah. So the question is, can you actually specify the steps you want to take in scaling? You now saw it going from 4 to 8 to 16, and it will probably go, it actually went to 20 after that, I think. I would not expect that to happen, really. I don't know. I don't think that the last time I looked at the specification, you couldn't specify the step there. So I think that there's other triggers for which you have a bit more control over it. You can actually specify it a bit more, but for the Q1, you cannot. So I don't actually know why it went from 16 to 20. That's actually an interesting one. Maybe it does that based on the number of things that's left on the queue. I don't know, really. Yeah, we don't have time. When I have more time than 30 minutes, I actually have a demo on Prometheus. What you can do, Prometheus is one of the triggers. So what you can do is do a query on the data in Prometheus and then scale based on whatever comes back. As long as you create a query that gives a number back, you're good to go. Yeah. And so I have a demo in which I have a web application, and based on the number of requests per second, I scale out. Yeah, so you can do that. And that's the fact that you can actually do that with Prometheus is pretty powerful, because whenever you put anything in there, it allows you to scale based on that data. That's actually true. So just for the record, this is being recorded. You can actually also add your own scalers if you want to. It's an open source project, so you can actually add it to the project as well. But there's also ways to just create your own scalers as well. Yeah, so in that sense, it's pretty easy to use, and doesn't really matter. Based on what you want to scale, you can actually do that. All right, let's wrap up. Thanks for having me.